Hello, my name is Sydney Halpin, and I'm the president of the New Jersey Jazz Society, and I'd like to welcome you to tonight's March Social. I'm very excited. Tonight we are featuring the Mariel Bildsten Quartet, a fierce, fabulous woman in honor of Women in History Month. So I'm so delighted. We'll get to that in just a second. Couple bits of housekeeping before we get started. I would like to remind everybody that the New Jersey Jazz Society is celebrating its 50th anniversary this year. If you'd like to know more about the agency or you'd like to become a member, we are funded primarily through membership. Or if you'd like to just simply learn more or to make a donation, please go to our website, njjs.org. We produce a fantastic award-winning magazine monthly that is part of membership. However, if you've joined us this evening and you aren't a member, I'd like to give you access, take a look at the magazine, and perhaps I would encourage you to become a member. The password for the month of March is Mood Indigo. It is case sensitive, capital M, capital I. There is a space between the two words, so you'll type in mood space indigo, and you'll be able to access the magazine and download it for your viewing pleasure, or be able to access the website at your leisure. And that magazine is produced 11 times a year. So perhaps if you see like what you see, you'll come back and want to read it again. I'd also like to thank everybody who has donated to this year's annual appeal campaign. We had a goal of $20,000. We've raised $19,500. So if anybody would like to make a donation and get us to our goal of $20,000, I would greatly appreciate that. All of that money goes toward our programming. So again, thank you very much to all of you who have generously donated to this campaign. It is our largest campaign to date. So again, thank you very, very much. Before we get started, I have some funding language I need to read, and we are so grateful for this funding through Morris Arts. So funding for the New Jersey Jazz Society Socials has been made possible in part by Morris Arts through the New Jersey State Council on the Arts, Department of State, a partner agency of the National Endowment for the Arts. We are incredibly grateful to them, to all of those agencies, for believing in jazz and for believing in the Jazz Society and affording us the luxury of our programming. So tonight, as I mentioned, I am so delighted, as are my colleagues, my board colleagues, delighted to present the Mariel Bildsten Quartet. So without further ado, enjoy the program. Thank you. Thank you.
Wonderful Dan, who's doing sound for us, so thank you, Dan. Let's hear it for Barry Stevenson on bass, and the wonderful Matisse Picard on piano. That was a song, one of my favorites. I mean, we're playing all my favorites tonight. So today, we are coming live to you from Fort Myers, Florida. We are down here and on tour at the moment, and we were lucky enough to get a space to record this in. So so thank you to Dan and thank you to Shell Point for having us. So that first song was called Almost Like Being in Love. We're gonna play another song now. This one's written by Oscar Pettiford, the late great bass player. And this is a song that he wrote entitled Trichotism.
Thank you.
By Duke Ellington, well, it's written by Duke Ellington that features Ella Fitzgerald. And on this tour that's led by Riley Mulherker, he's playing trumpet, and it's an amazing band featuring three vocalists, one of whom is named Chanel Johns. She's an incredible vocalist, so I highly encourage you to check out her work and her singing. And she sings this song that we've been working on the road, and she's made me cry about every time we play it. So in honor of her and in honor of Ella Fitzgerald and the whole legacy of beautiful melody presenters, we're gonna play this song called I've Got It Bad and That Ain't Good by Duke Ellington. Do you want to do an intro on this? Oh,
Thank you.
Thank you for sticking with us. The next song that we are going to play is one by Vincent Eumanns, and this is a song entitled Sometimes I'm Happy. And the lyrics say, sometimes I'm happy, sometimes I'm blue. And I think that's true for all of us sometimes. So here is Sometimes I'm Happy.
Thank you.
Songs. This one I discovered, like I discover most songs, by hearing something on a record and then getting excited about it because I think it's beautiful, and then kind of going on a deep dive into other versions and the history and the stories behind it and the people behind it. And this is a prime example of that. So I first heard this song, which is entitled Rosita, on an amazing record that's featuring Coleman Hawkins and Ben Webster. There's a beautiful version of this song by the two of them. And the first time I heard it, I just couldn't believe that this thing existed. I had this most beautiful, warm, fuzzy feeling. And I just loved the song and kind of fell in love with it. And from doing some more research, I found out that it was a theme song from a silent film called Rosita, and it was written by Paul DuPont. And there's a couple different versions of it out there, but it's the soundtrack to the silent film. And so this is our version of the song Rosita. And just as a little plug, this is also on my record that came out in November of 2020 with my quintet. And that album is entitled Backbone. You can find it anywhere you stream music, as well as on my website. So if you'd like to purchase it, you can. I can leave links and do things like that. There's a beautiful version of that song on my record that features Stacy Dillard on soprano saxophone and tenor saxophone, Ben Wolf on bass, Evan Sherman on drums, Sean Mason on piano, and myself. But here's our version today with this amazing band. And so here is Rosita. Hope you enjoy.
One, two, three, four. Yeah.
First introduced to this song by an amazing singer named Cecile McLaurin-Salvant, and she's wonderful. Check her out. She just came out with a new album called Ghost Song that's absolutely stunning. I was lucky enough to listen to it on, we've been doing a lot of traveling on this tour, and therefore a lot of time to listen to new music, which is, it feels like a real perk of being on the road. It's great conversations and a lot of time to listen and read, and so it's a sort of a nice time where life's a little more simple. I'm not doing as much running around in the snow, which is how I feel like most of life is in New York, where we all live. So, but we're sweating now, so you know,
we appreciate
you win some, you lose some. So much sweat do you want? So this is a song entitled "I Don't Know What Time It Was." Maybe right on it.
In E minor.
An F, so the first chord's E. Do you want to set aside like it on this one again?
Thank you.
Thank you.
So much to Sydney Halpin and all the people at the New Jersey Jazz Society for inviting us to play for their gala. We hope you had an absolute blast, just like we did. It's really nice to play. We have sound check after this, so we're happy to be able to play in a little more unstructured format. So thank you so much for having us. Enjoy the rest of the event. Let's hear it one more time from Matisse Picard on piano. And then Barry Stevenson on the bass. TJ Redick on the drums. My name is Mariel Bildsten. Thank you. We're going to play one more song for you as a bit of dessert to send you off with. And this song is another one of my favorites. This is called I'm in the Mood for Love. Thank you so much. I know you don't need to get home safe because this is a virtual thing. I hope you're home with lots of booze around you and that you're having a good time. So thank you so much for having us, and we will see you very soon. To leave you off, this is I'm in the Mood for Love. We'll make it short. Right on it. One, two, one. Shell Point for having us and for recording us. So thank you. We hope you enjoyed, and we'll see you next time. One more time for Matisse. Thank you. Take care.
Wow, thank you for such an amazing concert, and thank you for joining us for the Q&A portion. I know it's always, certainly to myself, it's always very interesting to learn about the artists, and I know a little bit about you, but I want the world to know a little bit more about you. So as I mentioned, March is Women in History Month. So obviously we have chosen to highlight a fierce, fabulous female for talent for this social. And I would like to talk to you a little bit about the uniqueness, if you will, of being a female trombonist. I know when, you know, kids pick instruments, at least when I was in school, nobody encouraged me to pick up a trombone. And ironically, my father was a trombonist. So talk to me a little bit about how you have come to love and be so well known as a, you know, fierce female trombonist, and what that means to you.
Sure. I was very fortunate to have a band director when I was 10 years old not steer me away from the instrument. And I just loved it. I thought it was a really fun instrument that reminded me of the circus. And at the time, I just enjoyed that. And so I wasn't, you know, from a young age, I wasn't discouraged from picking up a larger instrument that may have been seen as a boy's instrument. There is nothing anatomically that prevents women from playing any instrument. And in terms of like lung capacity or anything like that, it just doesn't exist. It's not an issue. And so I was very fortunate to have teachers that encouraged me to play this instrument. And I think that, you know, from then on, it was just, okay, let me learn this thing. And I haven't really, as I play, I'm not thinking I'm a woman playing. It's just what I love to do. And all of that just sort of melts away once we're getting into the music making. So I was very fortunate to have educators that didn't, you know, question that choice and encourage that choice. So I think that's when we're thinking about advocacy for young women, I think it's just important to leave those options open and not to make the decision for young students. And I think a lot of that has to do with visibility as well. You know, can you see somebody that looks like you doing a thing? I think that's something that's really important in any field, just to say, okay, oh, that it's actually possible. Because when you're young, maybe you don't even know what's possible yet. So I was very lucky to have educators that showed me that was possible.
Oh, that's amazing. You know, God love the people that are still teaching music in schools with all the crazy cuts and, you know, lack of funding for school programs. You know, those programs that still do exist are so, so, so important. Tell me a little bit, do you have a favorite historical jazz figure, a trombonist or not? I mean, you know, when you were starting out as a 10-year-old, did you have a concept of jazz, or is that something that you've come to know and appreciate certainly as you've gained momentum in the field?
Sure. So when I picked it up, I just wanted to play music with my friends was really the only reason that I joined band at all. And so it's been a slow process. I mean, at that time, it was a very slow process of learning jazz and even being aware of it. I didn't grow up in a household with jazz musicians. And so that wasn't in the airwaves. What was in the airwaves was like a lot of Neil Young and REM and a lot of rock music, which is what my parents really enjoyed listening to. And so again, back to the education thing, in middle school, there was a jazz band and I was able to join that and it was really fun. And we got to play all sorts of different charts, Duke Ellington and Basie and, Weather Report. There was just like a whole range of music that was really fun to play. And I also had a wonderful trombone teacher named Bryce Craig, who was a local trombonist in Santa Barbara. That's where I grew up. And he made me a mix CD of J.J. Johnson and Frank Rosalino and Curtis Fuller. And I remember putting on the J.J. Johnson record. I think it was The Trombone Master is the name of that record. And I just couldn't believe that the trombone could sound like that, because I was truly awful at that time. And I didn't have any, I mean, there were very few role models in my life that were playing like great trombone. And so that just really got me excited about the music, really got me excited about playing the trombone and getting better at it, because I was able to hear, oh, this thing that I really suck at could be amazing. But like, I've got a long way to go to get there. So, you know, that was amazing that he exposed me to that music. And then, yeah, it's been a slow, I mean, there's been many sort of pivotal moments for me, throughout my, you know, about throughout my life where I've just fallen more and more in love with the music and have learned so much, and that continues to happen. And I hope that that never ends, because there is so much amazing music being made now, being made in the past. And yeah, so my favorite trombonists, I mean, J.J. Johnson's kind of top of the list, Curtis Fuller. I love Lawrence Brown. He was Duke Ellington's longtime trombone player. I love Mel Bildsten. She was an arranger as well, so she's a big inspiration for me. Yeah, there's a ton out there, but those are probably my top four.
That is an amazing answer. So that lend me a thought. Is that teacher still living?
Yes, he's young. I hope he's living. He wasn't very.
No, I was wondering if you'd had any contact with him, or you know, if he's reached out to you in any way to be, you know, to share in his pride for your incredible trajectory as a trombonist.
You know, as you're saying that, I'm reminded I need to reach out to him. I'll put that on the to-do list. It's been a long time.
Fair enough. So. Talk to me a little bit about, you are known as a, you know, band leader. You are known as a side woman. You are known as a featured artist, and you're certainly known. I know that you do compose your own music. And I want to say, having heard some of your compositions played in a concert alongside with, you know, something, you know, written by Dizzy Gillespie or something by Duke Ellington, you know, your music, in my opinion, holds up, you know, with the quote, the, you know, great composers. How do you go about, well, first of all, how did you come about to become a composer? Because I do not have a composing gene in my body. So how did you come about to do that? And you know, how do you work that process? What goes into that when you're creating a new piece of music?
Sure. I feel very, very, very new to composing, because I am. In the past year, I've been taking piano lessons with my good friend, John Thomas, who's an amazing piano player and teacher. And that has been an amazing tool for me to just understand how music works and to get some of these ideas that I've had in mind out. You know, there are some frustrations with playing trombone where you don't have chordal information, you don't have harmony, because you can only play one note at a time. And so for me, the piano has been an absolute game changer to just understand how things work. which I feel is just something that I'm constantly working at. So thank you for the compliment, but I really feel like such a baby when it comes to composing. I feel less of a baby about arranging, because I've been working on that for a little bit longer. But again, back to the piano, back to listening, to so many, I mean, just to a lot of music and to, I mean, my arranging process is that I go on these rabbit hole dives, once I've fallen in love with a song and just sort of hear as many different versions by singers, by horn players, by piano trios, and just try to kind of puzzle something together of, oh, I love this aspect from this arrangement, and I love this from this, and let me synthesize this in my, the way that I want to play it and the way that I want to hear the song. So that is a really fun process that is, I mean, all of it is hard. I don't have an easy time with any of it. But it's really fun because I'm able to sort of piece something together. So that process is much more comfortable. As a composer, I am truly, truly, truly a baby. So I can't really speak to my process because I feel so new to it, but piano is the short answer.
So for anyone listening, that's amazing. Did you tinker on the piano growing up, or is that, I mean, you know, you, obviously you've been in rooms with a piano before, but I mean, when you're saying you're taking piano lessons from the gentleman you referenced, who is clearly a, you know, master pianist, fine pianist, you know, I mean, I would find that a little bit daunting to go in and take piano lessons, you know, because we all think of piano lessons as the do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do, you know, kind of learning your scales and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So, you know, to pick up piano now and use it as a composing tool or an arranging tool for you, that seems like a Herculean leap to me. So you must have had some exposure to the piano before, yes?
A little bit. When I was a kid, I went to, before picking up trombone at all, I took 3 years of piano lessons and absolutely hated them. It was sort of my mom took piano lessons when she was a kid and hated them. So she thought, let's keep that tradition going, of piano torture. So then I was very kind of adverse to it. And I took piano classes in college because you're required as a conservatory student to take them, but I never took it seriously. And I mean, every person I talked to, if I talked to any jazz masters, Dizzy Gillespie says this all the time. Charlie Parker is, it's like piano, 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 piano. Like everybody's saying it. And I was just, it was like the sort of mountain that I was not ready to step onto. And so finally, I think it was during the pandemic, I was just feeling like, wow, it is time for me to figure this out. And I need help. And I need a teacher. And I felt very fortunate to be friends with John, and we went to school together. And he's an amazing teacher who's very structured. And anyway, I have so much more to learn. I mean, I'm so at the beginning of it, and I can barely play things at a real tempo. I'm not ready to play with a band on piano, but for me, just to understand chord voicings and to really get into that has been really wonderful, and has already been, I mean, just in the short amount of time that I've been studying, it has been a total game changer in terms of how I understand music and how I think about music and how I can now feel like I can write music. So it's a slow process, but I'm really happy that I'm finally like doing the thing.
That's great. That's an amazingly fabulous answer as well, too. Do you, I have seen you in real time as a jazz educator, both with young, children of all ages plus adults. I want you to talk a little bit about that, because I think you've referenced it multiple times already about how education has been so vital and so important to you. Obviously, the Jazz Society feels that jazz education is critical. And I personally, you know, lament that kids today don't have the kind of music programs that I was exposed to growing up. Mm-hmm. So talk to me a little bit about, I know you work in the jazz education department via Lincoln Center. So talk a little bit about that, and talk a little bit about your, you know, your philosophy, if you will, about jazz education.
Sure. Yeah, so I'm a band leader with Jazz and Lincoln Center's program, which is called Jazz for Young People. I also did a lot of work in nonprofit organizations right out of college, actually, right when I was in college when I started teaching for a program called Upbeat NYC and another program called the Harmony Program, which are based in, they're kind of modeled after a program called El Sistema that comes from Venezuela, which is, the concept is that by teaching students music as early as possible and for as long as possible, society is better, they are better, and there's just more beauty around, and that the skills that come from learning an instrument and showing up for it every day and being exposed to music serves the student times a billion throughout life. And so there's a really amazing TED Talk by the man who started this program, El Sistema. I will send you a link. But anyway, that was my foundation of learning about education was in that. And I was able to go to, I was just teaching in the program for a few months when we got invited to go to Caracas and be there and watch how the program works. And it's incredible. It's just like, let's bring in as many kids as possible, get instruments in their hands, and just get them playing really high level classical music right away. So there's not too much dead time where you're just learning fundamentals or you're just learning things. Let's get people playing music as soon as possible and have so many students that even if one kid is kind of struggling here and another kid is struggling in that section, like there's just enough manpower that it's fine. So that was a real, I was not taught music that way. I mean, in certain ways I was, but it was just a huge eye-opening experience for me being there. And I learned a lot about how to teach from that program. And it was very inspiring to me. When I think about jazz education, it's sort of the same. I mean, that's all that can be applied to any music. And I think what's really important about teaching music is that it makes, I think, musicians are really special types of people, right? Because what it takes is to be a team member, to be a leader, to have a voice, to be to think for yourself, to listen, to respond, and those qualities are good. I believe they are good qualities that we, you know, that are important to instill in young people. To see a group of people working together that all look different, that are all different ages. That all come from different backgrounds. I think just all of that, both in the presentation of, you know, a show for young people and getting into the nitty gritty of teaching an instrument. I think it's just something that is perhaps hard to come by to really see that all the time. I'm not really sure. I see it all the time because this is the world I live in. But I think just those things to be able to see are really important. And on top of that, the music's just really good. and it's really fun. And there is so much spirit in it. And so aside from all the, you know, good qualities, like just to have a good time and to be able to get into that, I think is a fantastic thing. So as much as that is possible at every stage of life, I think just realizing that this music is meant to be danced to, it's meant to be exuberant and joyful and sometimes sad, and all of this just, you know, gets into the human experience. I think just all of that is so important for students to see. So that's my very long answer.
Well, no, that's a very terrific answer. And having seen you, like I said, in real time with students, it's infectious. You make it infectious. You make the story, not only the story of the history of jazz, you bring to life in such a unique and fun manner. But then, of course, the finer qualities of the music itself, you really do a superb job at that. Do you do private trombone lessons? Do you teach trombone lessons?
I do. Yeah. Okay. And yeah. Just finished a lesson just now.
Oh, there you go.
Yep.
Well, good. And do we dare ask, is that a student, a young lady or a young man?
An old man, actually.
Oh, yes. Well, yeah. I was discriminating and didn't even mean to be. Well, good for you. That's really fun. So tell us what you're working on now. I know you, well, there's a couple things, and perhaps I buried the lead here by not mentioning this up front, but there's been a lot of story, press, ado about the fact that you are now working as the lead trombonist for Arturo Afro. Is that correct? Do I have that correct?
That's correct. Yep.
So you play a wide, wide range of music. I know you do. I know you love a wide range of music. So tell us, can you give us a little bit of a snapshot on what it's like to play with Arturo, since being in the room with him is an incredible experience as a viewer? So tell us what it's like to be on the bandstand.
It's an absolute treat. I mean, the band has been around for a really long time. So Arturo is the son of Chico O'Farrell, who was one of the very founders of Afro-Latin, Afro-Cuban jazz in New York. He himself was from Cuba and immigrated, and he's an amazing piano player. So Arturo is his son. He's also an incredible, incredible piano player and composer and arranger. And so the band just has a lot of history steeped into it. There are people of all ages in the band, which is really a treat to play next to people who have been in the band for 25, 30 years. That's just a very unique experience for me. I think it's a very special. It feels like a special opportunity because I am sitting next to people who played with Chico and have been in the band forever and have such an understanding and sort of comprehension about that music and are so steeped into that music. And so I feel like the total noob, just sitting there like, okay, let me wrap my head around this and how to play this music. And it's really beautiful stuff. So it's a real treat and I'm learning a lot. I am also playing lead trombone, so I have a certain amount of responsibility. So I'm really getting my ass handed to me in a really good way. And I've found that that's how I learn most things, is just like, okay, like, let's figure it out. So it's amazing. And, it's been fun to play that music and to just try to, understand it as much as possible and just be in it. So, Arturo is an amazing band leader and the band is, you know, a group of incredible people. So it's great, great. It's really fun.
Well, congratulations on having that gig. And there is nothing like learning on the job, is there? Really put your feet to the fire. Has the band gone back to playing at Birdland? Is that a gig that's still standing? Why don't you tell our viewers where they could see that incredible band?
Yeah, we're there every Sunday at Birdland. The sets are at 8:30 and 10:30 in the evening. Anytime you're in the city on a Sunday, you can stop by. Which is really amazing too. I mean, that partnership with Birdland and Arturo's band has been around for, I think, 25 years, having that residency. So just to have, you know, for a band of that stature to have that sort of weekly thing, it's like the Vanguard band, or, you know, having that sort of weekly thing is huge, because we're able to really develop things and get a real sound. And then when we do these other gigs, we're sort of already prepped to go. So it's a treat to be able to be there every week.
Great. So in wrapping up, why don't you, what are you working on next? I know you have a CD out. Why don't you mention your latest CD that you put out, and then tell us what's coming next for you.
Sure. The CD that I released in November of 2020 is called Backbone. It's my quintet playing my arrangements of just the songs that I love. And it features Stacey Dillard on tenor saxophone, Ben Wolf on bass, Sean Mason on piano, and Evan Sherman on the drum, and myself. So that was a really fun record to make. I'm in the process of figuring out my next record, which will probably be quintet as well, but I'm sort of in the process of figuring that out. I am on the road right now with Riley Mulherker, who's an amazing trumpet player and band leader. So I'm zooming in from a hotel in Potsdam, New York. We just arrived here last night. So this tour ends in a couple of days, but that program is called The Songs We Love. And this is a band that was put together by Riley on behalf of Jazz Lincoln Center. So this has been really a really great tour. We've been playing these wonderful concerts in these beautiful spaces and featuring Buyo Satache and Chanel Johns and Brianna Thomas on the vocals. So that's been really a treat. So the next few months I'm going to be on the road with Brass Against, which is a rock band that I play with. I'm back in New York for like a month, and here and there I have my septet's playing at the Django on March 26th. So just to put that out there, that's next Saturday, I guess. So we play at 10:30 if anyone would like to come by. It's a late night, but if you drink some espresso.
Where is that concert? Where is the Django being played on the 26th? At Town Hall in New York?
The venue is called the Django, and it's down in Tribeca. Yeah, it's a fun spot. They have wonderful cocktails, and it's a great room to be in. I'm hoping that some people will dance, so we'll do everything we can to do that. I'll also be playing with my septet at Birdland on, I believe it's July 10th. So those are some gigs to look out for. I'll also be at the New Brunswick Jazz Project this coming Wednesday, the 23rd, with my quartet at Delta's in New Brunswick. So a lot of stuff coming up. I'm trying to take it week by week because it's a little bit crazy. But yeah, that's the plan, is go crazy this next month in New York and gone for a few months, and then go crazy again in the summer. So.
Well, congratulations. Yeah. Delighted to see that you and clearly several other musicians are getting back to the new normal, or at least working again and being out on the road again. I do want to say, with regards to your Backbone CD, it received remarkable critical acclaim. So brava on that. And I personally have it and I love it. So that's available for purchase via what, Amazon or CD Baby? Yeah. Or which...
All of those places. A really good place to get it is Bandcamp. That's the most direct way where you can pay for it and download it. It's also on all streaming platforms. And then if you come to a show of mine, I'll always have hard copies with me. So that's an easy way to get it. And I would love to say hi as well.
Okay. Well, I want to thank you so very much. Sounds like you could have used a sleeping in this morning, but I want to thank you so much for joining us and allowing us this part of the program. I would also like to mention that Mariel is an advisor to the Jazz Society, and I know she's personally been incredibly helpful to me with questions about education and program development and everything. So allow me to thank you very much on that. And look forward to seeing you at one of your next live concerts. And again, thank you for today's fabulous concert, because you and your bandmates did a superb job. And again, thank you so much for sharing your time and your talents with us. And we wish you all the best.
Thank you.
Have a great rest of your tour.
Thank you. Take care.